Welcome to the CS1 PC module. My name is Julian Kunkel and I am lecturer at the Department of Computer Science involved in teaching this module. Before we get started with the content, let me give you a short introduction to the module, which kind of complements the module roadmap that you find on Blackboard. Firstly, the staff involved in teaching is me. We will have also Christopher Maynard and Mohamed Al-Kafahi that also support you for teaching in this module. You will find the contact details in Blackboard. We also have various student assistants that help you during the practical part of this module. Today, you will get a couple of general information that is not assessed. Part of it is the module aims, the organization of the module, and the prescribed learning journey, but also a little bit background in regards to computer science and to put this module into perspective. The second part is that we will start with the lecture algorithmic thinking, part one of two. So generally, every week has a certain topic split into subtopics. This algorithmic thinking topic is actually consisting of two parts. So let's get started with an overview. So computer science involves the study of computers, design and their uses for computation, data processing and systems control, including the design and development of software and programming. The aspects marked in bold font here, they are actually part of this module, as well as the field encompasses theory, mathematical activities, we have design and analysis of algorithms, performance studies, and so on and so forth. Again, those parts are actually part of this module. To distinguish a little bit computer science and IT, I've added a couple of further terms. Firstly, computational science applies computer science to scientific problems like biology of physics. Okay, so that is kind of the boundary a little bit between science and application of computers for science. Then we have IT, which is information technology, which actually is about how to use a computer to store, retrieve, transmit and manipulate data or information effectively and efficiently. Okay, so that is more, I would say, the practical usage, while computer science in fact involves the design and the theory of these computers, as well as design analysis of algorithms. Okay, so this is a bit more theoretic than IT, and computational science then is the boundary between computer science and application in scientific domains. So here's a very nice quote. Computer science is no more about computers than astronomy is about telescopes. Right? After I studied computer science, or while I was studying computer science, I have been asked many times by, you know, family members, can you fix my computer? And I said, well, you know, in regards to Windows, I can't do so much. I'm sorry. And they said, but you study computer science. I say, yes, but this is about science, not so much about, you know, computers in terms of hardware. Right, so I hope you can distinguish now a bit IT from computer science further. So let me give a couple of examples how we can apply computer science. So one example is weather forecasting. Okay, so you want to compute the future weather. How do you do that? Well, you can simulate the physical processes that are inherent to the atmosphere and the ocean of the Earth, for example. Also, you can involve processes such as radiation of the sun, and you model this physical kind of ecosystem a little bit. And then you kind of make some progress in the simulation, moving from a current state to a next state, predicting what's going to happen. To do so, you need actually thousands of servers, thousands of computers that must work together to address this issue. You can't just compute the weather of tomorrow sufficiently accurate on your laptop. And as input, you would need the data collected over the past days, like temperature, rainfall, or pressure, and then you would get these prognostics of rain and temperature. This is really challenging and highly interdisciplinary work. And in fact, also part of the research that I'm doing. So let me give a little history. So the SET3 was the world's first working programmable, fully automatic digital computer. Here you can see an image. It was built actually with an electromechanical design using relays. In 1941, it had a frequency of 4 to 5 hertz, right? So 4 to 5 changes from on to off of power triggered the computation. Okay, so that an addition took about 0.8 seconds and a multiplication 3 seconds, and it weighed about 1 ton. Another milestone was the ENIAC, which was an electronic general purpose computer that could solve a large class of numerical problems. A couple of years later, it had already had 100 kilohertz as a frequency, and it took about 200 microseconds to do an addition and 3 milliseconds to do a multiplication. So it could do about 300 multiplications per second, but the thing weighed about 27 tons. Now, when you look at today, you have a smartphone that has a compute power a billion times faster, because we're talking about gigahertz, you have multiple cores, and so on. It's really so much faster than before, unimaginable from the past. So one of the most powerful supercomputers that exists in the world is Summit in the US, has a peak performance of 120 petaflops per second, which means millions of billions of floating point operations per second can be done. It comes also with 250 petabytes of storage and one image that only plots a subset of it shows the big system where you can see a lot of racks filled with servers, interconnections on the top, which are the microprocessors, and each microprocessor is connected, each of the servers is connected to a couple of graphics cards. You can think of it as a 122 petahertz computer, or about 30,000 times of whatever decent gaming PC you may have. Whatever kind of technology you have, how can we make use of these computer systems to solve complicated problems? Well, computers use algorithms to transform data into useful information, some kind of output that we want, which ties now into this module. So this module introduces students to computer programming. So it's really useful when you study this module that you will have a great understanding for subsequent programming languages that you will learn in your life. And programming is really core of computer science. I'm sorry. Programming means you are able to articulate and formulate a complex problem and have the computer work for you, which is very nice. Okay, another aspect is that gives the foundation in algorithms and data structures. It shows you a little bit about system internals. And we use C and C++ basically as a programming languages to demonstrate those features, but at the same time you will learn C and C++ in detail. In our labs, we will learn a variety of supportive tools and concepts that are primarily tied into the Linux operating system in the autumn term. And the key learning objective of this module is that you will be able to design and implement moderately complex algorithms in both C and C++. More details can be found in the module description or in the module roadmap. So high-level overview to the module is as follows. In autumn, you learn the fundamentals of programming and the C language. We'll talk about problem solving, we'll talk about elementary algorithms and data structures, we'll talk about the C programming language, we'll talk about how we can develop applications, and, well, a bit more algorithms and data structures. In spring, we will look at the object-oriented programming model and the C++ language. So, supplementary to both parts are computing concepts, and we will look into system internals, that means how does a computer work, and really a lot of tools and environments to develop and analyze programs. Note, there is really a steep learning curve in this module, and as you are new to study in the university, please keep it up, persevere, and communicate with us, and you will make good progress. So there are a lot of CS topics, and I made a selection and an excerpt of Wikipedia that this module touches a little bit. Of course, we talk about data structures and algorithms, We talk about computer architectures and a little bit about computer security, because C and C++, well, they are very prone to errors, so they are an issue for computer security, and we talk about software engineering. All those other little topics are a little bit addressed as well, but more about them in other modules. So I've been asked in the past a couple of times, why do we learn C? Well, first of all, C is still one of the most important programming language in the world. So there is an index that describes how how employers look for qualifications and what programming languages, and C is still number 2 in this list, and C++ is number 4. So employers really appreciate it. Personally, I have to say, I think C allows teaching of fundamentals that are hidden in other languages, so you can really understand how a computer works by understanding C. And next, C is widely available on basically any system in the world. And even outside the world, like the Mars rover, you find ways to deal with them and program them. You can use with C any available architectural feature provided by your system. C is efficient and performant if well programmed, and C is the foundation of many other programming languages. Well, and with, as part of this course, you will learn the theory of programming, which ties really well into the history of C, because C was one of the first programming languages as well. So how is this module organized? So first of all, we have 2 hours a week, this kind of lecture, where we deliver the main concepts and give you some hints for further reading. Not everything that you will find on the slides will be read out loud, albeit in this recording I will try to make it a bit more verbose than I would normally in the lecture hall. So it will be a bit longer to give you more insights. Lecture includes some active learning that was normally scheduled as group work, but now you can basically think about it by yourself, and you can also communicate with peers during the scheduled lecture time to on Teams, for example, and have a little chat. So then we have a tutorial, which is 1 hour a week as part of our practical. So our 2 hour practical session, which is part of the interactive sessions that you have due to the COVID situation. 1 hour of it is a tutorial where we introduce every week new tools or environments in some kind of presentation, give you a walkthrough, and to get you started with this new technology for you. Okay, so the typical obstacles will be covered. Then we have exercises that will be handed out on a weekly basis, and it's prescribed that you try to attempt them for 3 hours a week at least. And it's basically self-study for you to practice the lecture content. You can team up to to approach this task. That's all fine, because it won't be summatively assessed. Each task will come in with an estimated time for you to spend on, and we have a couple of introductory and harder tasks, and we will talk about how we can manage this kind of portfolio very nicely, that you gain benefits during your studies from all that you have produced. So as part of this 2 hour interactive session, we also have a practical, which is 1 hour a week, tightly connected to the tutorial. And as part of this practical, first of all, we discuss the exercises that you have done until that time. And secondly, we discuss the new exercise. We also sometimes do a little bit of group work, and this also ties into tutorial. In the tutorial, we do also some group work in these interactive sessions, which are useful for you. How this works in detail, you will see when you attend the first tutorial / interactive session / practical. Okay, supportive, we also have a drop-in session, which is 2 hours a week. This is optional, where you can get one-to-one support and discuss tutorial or exercises, for example. It's really an offer for you. If you struggle or have concerns, join this session and get some benefit by discussing in a small group with the lecturer. Let me talk a little bit about the role of exercises in group work. Basically, days are essential to learn programming. It is essential. Repeat that. Skills like algorithmic thinking and programming are like learning a language. You need a lot of practice. Okay? You can't just read a programming book like you can't just read the book about English language, where every verb is defined and the grammar is defined, and you say, now I know English, right? It's the same. That's why it's called programming language. Similar to a real language, okay? So we provide a framework that you can use to test your exercise development. So it works for a couple of the codes, and then you can make sure that you get the right outcome. This helps with your self-study. So we have a couple of quizzes provided on Blackboard for your self-study, and we have this active learning in form of group work, where we discuss and provide feedback of exercises using the peers. Sometimes we have also brainstorming sessions or design or solve a small task in groups. It's really up to you and up to your learning to make the best of these opportunities that we provide. Good. In terms of communication online resources, let me say first, effective communication is a key ingredient for success. Okay, if you have any problem doing your study, communicate. Communicate with your peers, but also communicate with the lecturer. Because sometimes your peers may have a suboptimal opinion. Okay? There is no shame to ask us anything, and I suppose you have a lot of opportunity to practice this aspect. Well, then we have Blackboard, that you know, where we have most of the material, announcements and such. We will have a Git repository of what this is. You learn in 2 weeks. We use Teams as a channel for communication, and you can use it for any purpose around the topic. So for help solving exercises, for sharing information, or to find peers to work with. So we have a couple of online training courses that we are linked in our reading list. The module assessment. Now I hope most of you are fully awake and pay attention. That's about getting your mark. Firstly, the 100% that this 20 credit module is worth are distributed into 30% for the practical assignment and 70% in the written exam that you will see in the summer term. The practical work is decomposed into 2 tests, one in week 5 and one in week 10 and one in test in spring, each worth 5% of this overall 30%. So that makes up 15%, right? In spring, we have a bigger development project from week 5 to week 10, which is worth the remaining 15%. So what is the content of the test? Well, the content of the test is basically the weekly exercises and a bit of theory from the lecture. To pass, you have to have 40% overall. So let me say again something about my idea for your learning journey. Or phrasing differently, how can you obtain good marks? Firstly, you must understand the learning outcomes that are provided in slide 2 of each slide deck, right? The learning outcomes clearly describe what you should learn and should be able to do after you worked yourself through the lecture, right? So that doesn't mean you will be able directly after the lecture to do these tasks, because you may need to read the lecture again and understand the different topics, right? But it means this is the goal that you should achieve when you look and practice a little bit into the lecture material. Good. Well, you should participate in tutorials and exercises very actively. Ask questions, and they really help to understand the topic. And you will get, as part of this tutorials and exercise, you will get feedback from the lecturer and also from the student demonstrator about your progress. So this is formative assessment. It helps you to understand, where are you? Are you making good progress? And what should you do to improve further? Secondly, as part of these exercises, I strongly advise you to schedule time in your weekly plan and already budget. You know, say, on Friday afternoon, I have a 3-hour block where I do my exercises, right? And if we have a couple of tasks, always do some of these tasks, particularly the easier ones, right? If you can't do everything, it's not a big deal. Partial solutions are better than no attempt at all. Secondly, read the new exercise sheet quickly before the practical, that you can ask questions that you get the questions that are written there, the exercises, right. Next, do the quizzes because they prepare you well for the tests. Do further reading if you want to, and you should do, if particularly if you are new to programming, you may want to read a little bit into additional complementing material to the lecture, because sometimes you may not get a specific topic very well from me maybe, but when you use a second literature material, you may understand it better, and vice versa. So it's always good that we have not a single source of information, but at least two sources of information which are slightly different. Then team up again to prepare for the exam, and of course to prepare for tests, right? Ask yourself questions, each other, and ask a lot of questions to us and to your colleagues. So we are here to support your learning journey, and we try really hard to really be responsive and support you with all what you have. But you are responsible for the learning journey that you are doing. If you never ask us anything, right, and you never show up to tutorials and exercises, you don't do a quiz, and then you go into the test, well, there is a high chance that you get a bad mark. Last year I did actually do some kind of correlation with this that clearly indicates that it's beneficial to participate in those activities. Okay? You can ask me more about it if you are interested. So we advise you to create a repository, which is a little bit like a directory where you store everything that you learn from this module and that you develop, and you keep it there during the studies and of course afterwards, right? You must really, again, study programming a lot and practice it. And trial and error helps you, so it's good to store different products and come back to them maybe in a year, and you will be surprised what you have kind of produced. So let me talk a little bit about the exercises. Learning programming is difficult, and the exercises support you. There are hints on this lecture material, on the exercises, and check the lecture material, right? I heard, it's not the first time that I would hear some people asking, you know, I spent 3 hours on it, I couldn't solve it. And I said, well, what was the problem? You look at the problem, you say, but actually this issue that you describe here, there was a hint written 4 lines afterwards. And, oh, I didn't read it. Yes, you would wonder how often I hear that, right? Reading is really important. Not only because we are at the University of Reading, but reading and understanding what you have been delivered by the lectures is key to your success. Okay, let me ask, describe a little bit, you know, the marking, right? Because there have been some confusion before. The marks that you will probably get in this module, they are so aligned that you will get them according to the UK standard in higher education. That means 40% means that you already understand basics. So that means if at the end of this module you get 40% and you are totally new to programming and never have done any computer science, I'd say this is a good start. You haven't failed. You did sufficiently well, right? You made it, right? 50% means you do a good job, and 70% means you get a first, which is an excellent mark, okay? Rarely you will get marks above 70%. So it will be that some tasks appear to be very difficult to you. Don't give up, okay? You will learn a lot when you discuss them during the labs, and that's the purpose of the labs. So team up, ask questions to peers and us again. Use 50% of the time that is scheduled and ask for help, right? Always ask for help if you can't do something and it appears you won't be able to do it for a couple of further hours, okay? So if you have any questions regarding the module organization, right, write me either in Teams or drop me an email. Again, let me say there is really a steep learning curve in this module, and you are new to the way of studying at the university. And there will be many new tools and concepts that you will learn as part of the tutorial. But I have to say, I am 100% certain that they will pay off, and it will pay off for you to learn them now for the rest of your studies. So keep it up, persevere, and communicate.